So as you can see, as that wave travels, the crests arrive every big T seconds. And big T can be anything. And the wave crests are lambda meters apart. And so therefore, the speed of the wave is V, is lambda over big T, lambda over the period, which we define as lambda times the frequency of the wave. The frequency of a wave is how often wave crests are hitting you, how many times per second. And we measure that in units of hertz, but hertz is simply one per second. It has nothing to do with the car rental company. It comes from Heinrich Hertz, who lived in the 19th century and was the first guy to show that you could set up an electromagnetic disturbance over here and detect it over there, that there were electromagnetic waves traveling through space. It had been predicted, but actually doing the experiment to show that you could produce and detect them obviously led to all the wonderful radio technology we have today. Anyway, so he's honored, as we honor many physicists, by naming a unit after them. So far, there's no unit of Conway yet, but we'll get there, maybe. Now, the speed of a wave depends on a lot of things. But one thing it doesn't depend on is the frequency of the wave. Okay? The velocity through the medium can be different. It's different for, in the case of earthquakes, for example, is an interesting example. Pressure waves from an earthquake travel faster through the earth, which is basically solid material, faster than the shear waves, which are bigger and tend to do a lot more damage in an earthquake. So how many of you felt the earthquake last August 24th at 3 in the morning? That was my first California earthquake, first earthquake anywhere. And it kind of was a wake-up call for me. I thought Davis was a place where we don't have earthquakes, right? But it turns out that we could get hit by a pretty big one. So, of course, I went out right after that and got an earthquake alarm. And my wife says, yeah, right, an earthquake alarm is going to tell you that an earthquake is happening. It works. Here's how it works. Suppose there's another big earthquake, either in the Napa Fault there again, or the more likely, let's say, the Hayward Fault. And that's a good 80 kilometers away, right? 60 to 80 kilometers away. The pressure waves in an earthquake travel about 60% faster than the shear waves from an earthquake. And the shear waves do a lot more damage. So my little earthquake meter is a simple pendulum that sits on the wall. And if the wall shakes due to an earthquake, it'll put out a big noise. And then I know that I have about 20 to 40 seconds to prepare for incoming shear waves. And when that earthquake hit in August, I was standing and it was like this in our house. And there's cracks all over our plaster now inside the house. And we didn't have too much stuff fall off the shelves, but I no longer am of the opinion that we couldn't, that we're never going to get a big one that affects Davis, because I think we are at some point. The Hayward Fault's likely to let loose sometime in the next 20 to 30 years with a pretty big earthquake, so be prepared. Anyway, I'll at least get about 20 seconds of warning, and that might be enough to get the... you'd like to have a few days, but it's not. They don't have that technology quite yet. For some media like water waves, the frequency can depend on wavelength. We're not going to consider that here. Maybe should think of it the other way around, that the wavelength depends on the frequency, but it depends on your point of view. Now, for glass, you do have dispersion in terms of different light travels through glass at different speeds depending on its wavelength. That's why you can get nice rainbows coming from prisms, and we'll come to that a little bit later. But we won't really be considering that in the first couple weeks of this course. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Why is velocity not affected by frequency? Didn't you say that?
Right. Let's go back to that for a second. Consider that I have some source of disturbance, right? If I put out 10 waves per second here, no matter how fast they go, when they arrive at the other end, 10 per second are going to happen. There's no compression of time. You can't have it if you have a disturbance here, 10 per second, you can't have 20 per second over here, right? It's a key thing for analyzing a lot of physics problems is to realize that the frequency of a wave will not change with other conditions. The wavelength could change. Now, if you're moving toward or away from the source of the disturbance, the source of the wave, the frequency can appear to change, right? Because if you're moving and the wave's moving, wave crests will arrive where you are either more slowly or faster. But the frequency of a wave will not change. We'll get to various examples of this, and you'll see a little bit better what we mean by this. Now, the equation that we just wrote down two slides ago describes what we call a plane wave. What do we mean by a plane wave? The idea of a plane wave is that the wave crests occupy planes, infinite planes in space. Certainly the way that we wrote down that equation, that's the case. Now imagine a pressure wave. Rather than writing just some generic y, we're writing down p here. P means, let's say, pressure. Now, same equation, 2 pi t over t minus 2 pi x over lambda plus phi is the wave equation, just the same way that we wrote it down when we said y of x and t. But now, we've explicitly put x, y, z, and t in the argument of the function. The function is pressure as a function of x, y, z, three-dimensional space, like the space of this room, and time. Now, if I were far enough away from you, the sound coming out of my mouth, forget about the fact that it's amplified through speakers and all that, imagine me as being a point source of a sound wave. Those waves travel out in spheres away from me. Well, by the time they reach you, they're sort of flat sheets hitting you, especially if I were farther away. I'm close enough to you that the wave coming from my mouth goes in that direction that way and 90 degrees away over there, but let's just ignore that for a minute. Or imagine a radio wave from a distant transmitter. By the time it reaches you, you have sheets of wave crests coming toward you. What this equation is saying, you see no y and no z on the right-hand side of that equation. That doesn't mean that there's nothing happening in y and z. It just means that for any y or for any z, you get the same value of whatever this is, pressure, let's say. Okay? So when you have something happening at a certain x and it's the same everywhere in y and z, that's a plane. That's a plane at x equals some value and for all y and z. And that's what we mean by a plane wave, that the wave crests are coming in big sheets, big flat sheets, okay? One after the other after the other. And that's what this equation describes. So even though we first wrote down y of x and t, y was probably a bad choice for the function itself. This is a better choice, p, because it's not a, doesn't look like a space coordinate at all. So this is a plane wave propagating in the plus x direction. An animation of this looks like this. Now here you have these sheets and here they're propagating from left to right. And you can imagine that I don't have a three-dimensional projector, right? But the sheet would extend all the way out in the classroom for all x and y to infinity, and these sheets are moving in this direction as the wave travels. So that's what we mean by a plane wave. And if you're sufficiently far away from a point disturbance, and the spheres or whatever have gotten so big that now the waves arriving at you can be very, very closely approximated by a plane wave. And in fact, you know, think about your ear. There are waves passing by your head coming out of, you know, the sound waves coming out of my mouth. reach your ear, and as they're passing by, it's flat sheets of pressure waves. It's actually amazing that the human ear works, or that the ears of creatures like us work so well, considering how it's just one mouth, but hundreds of ears in here, all being able to detect that tiny little vibration of the molecules in the air. When you actually look at how much energy is being carried by that wave, it's tiny. It's 10 to the minus 12th watts or something like that per square meter. Very small.